organization, we are looking into the various activities regarding the vice chancellorship in the University of Ibadan. And we want to know your manifesto and want to know what you have in stock for the University of Ibadan if you become the vice chancellor of this university. Hi, I'm Kayo Debilu, and with me is
Lawuli Mustafa from the Tourism Department.
Thank you very much. Well, my name is Francis Egbokhare. I'm a professor of linguistics in the Department of Linguistics and African Languages, University of Ibadan. I've been in this university now for over 30 years. I've been a professor for more than 16 years in this university. And I must say that I have been part of the strategic actions of this university, like the strategic plans, the one from 2009 to 2014, and the current one that has been put together under the current Vice Chancellor, Professor Adewale. I was part of the College of Medicine Blueprint Committee. I have been involved in various grant initiatives, both at a personal level as well as an institutional level. I've been involved in principal investigator in a number of grants in this university. And you will understand that in the Faculty of Arts, where such funds are not easily available, that's quite some remarkable thing to have that kind of university-wide kind of acceptance. I am basically now more a consultant in open and distance learning and in the management of higher education, where I teach strategic planning, I teach monitoring and evaluation, and assist institutions also to engage in strategic thinking. Basically, as director of Distance Learning Center for 6 years under the leadership of Professor Falaji and Professor Pamero, I was able to turn the center, which then was called Siberia. It was like a place where university officials who were going to retire, or who the university wanted to get rid of, or who were ill, or who were just not part of the equation of development in the institution were sent to, until Professor Falache, the then Vice Chancellor, decided to do something about it as part of the strategic agenda of the university to improve IGL. So I succeeded the Professor Biola Adejide, who set the tone for change. And at the time I took over the place, it was barely able to generate enough money. It was just making progress in generating enough money. Maybe about 20 million or thereabout was in the account, which it had actually. It was remarkable because before Professor Odeyide got there, it was just not a center to talk about at all. But within 4 years, it became the primary IGR organ of UI. You know, by God's grace, with the staff and I and the support of the then vice chancellors. It became a billion naira plus center, and you can see that it has surpassed the postgraduate school as its primary source of IGR on campus. So what I did then, basically, I still have the capacity, and in fact, I'm even better positioned today to tackle some of those the issues that UI is facing today. The point basically is that if you ask anybody today, they may tell you that the problem of the University of Ibadan is actually a problem of funding. They'll tell you, they'll raise issues about funding, they'll raise issues about management, and but if you look at the history of these institutions, right from the 1973 thereabout, you will observe that the same issues have recurred. And elementary system dynamics tells us that when issues start to recur that way over a period of time, it shows you that there's a problem with the system, that there's a fundamental problem with the substructure. The primary problem of the University of Ibadan, I think, is not a problem of what you call it, funding. Funding and the problem of infrastructure as we see today are actually symptoms of a more fundamental problem having to do with the fact of that we are strategic rigidity. The problem of leadership, both in terms of the incompetent and in terms of technical competence and managerial competence, we are still using the same colonial caste system that we inherited in 1948 when the university was was set up. We, in fact, if you look at the work of Vandenberg, 1973, we're told that even at the time when we took the British system that we inherited, this system was already being phased out in Britain itself. And so we are still basically locked in that rigid colonial caste system. And you will see it when you enter into University of Ibadan in terms of its organizational structure and everything, that we are running an industrial age management system. This command and control, plan and push, that cannot lead to the kind of paradigm shift that we're looking for in the modern 21st century university. Now, what I'm bringing in into this is that we need a paradigm shift. It is not enough for us to continue to construct buildings, sometimes matchbox buildings, you know, poorly executed contracts, and spending a lot of money on all of these things. In the last 5 or 6 years, we probably have spent about 60 billion naira, received about 60 billion naira in receipts from the federal government, both for salaries and capital projects and so on, special interventions by TED Fund and so on and so forth. But if you look at the state of the library, you will ask yourself, why is the library worse off than it was 12 years ago? If you look at the state of the university farm, why is it worse off? Why is the dairy farm worse off than it was 12 years ago when we did not have these funds? If you look at the ICT, after over 1 billion naira spent by Makato Fund, you will ask yourself, why is the ICT not at the point where it can support administration? Why does UI not have a local area network, you know, that we don't need to go on the internet to access this? Why are we still spending so much money on facilities that are not working? We have spent over 253 million naira buying generators in 4 years. Now, if you look, go around, you will discover that the generators are all locked up. They are not being powered. Many of them are not being powered because the departments, before they realized they could not buy diesel, you would think that they would do some studies to find out exactly where they can fund the generators. So you bought generators, you discovered that you needed diesel. And because you could not afford diesel, you locked the generators up. We spent over 663 million naira buying cars. In 1 year, we bought over 24 cars. You see, there must be a congruence between purpose and behavior. If you find, for instance, that the university spends more money on cars than on research, in 7 years, we spent less than 100 million naira funding research from university funds. It means that whatever you do in terms of where you commit your money shows exactly what the purpose of your institution is. So we may be right to say that the University of Ibadan is a transport company and not a research organization. So our vision says we are aspiring to be a world-class institution for academic excellence, geared towards meeting societal needs. So basically what we need to focus on is exactly what are the parameters for world-class institutions. Benchmark ourselves against those parameters. Ask ourselves basic questions. Whether University of Ibadan is declining or are we making progress? If we are declining, how do we reverse it? If we are making progress, how do we now get to the point where we can be at the top of the pack? Now the other question is, we're talking about academic excellence. And you define academic excellence along certain parameters. Quality of research facilities, laboratories, diversity of the institutions, in terms of the staffing diversity, quality of staff. You know, no institution exceeds the quality of its teachers. No institution, education system exceeds the quality of its teachers. But what I have seen basically, in terms of is our library is just decrepit. You see, if you go to the library, you understand what I'm talking about, which is at the heart of academics basically. And we have lost focus. There's no congruence between our structure and our purpose. There's no congruence between our behavior and our purpose. So my own basic agenda is to come and reform, refocus, and then of course we will reform the administrative processes. We will refocus our resources in order for us to address the mandate of the university. And then of course we will also try to restore the academic excellence. Now, in 1973 and before, University of Ibadan was number three in the Commonwealth. If you say number three, that means we were probably one of the best 20 in the world. And there was no doubt about that. And you would tell us, I said, what did we do in those days that gave us that privileged position? even though we're a young university. And what are we not doing now? And I can tell you, if you go back in history, you will find five eras in the history of the University of Ibadan where certain things happened and the trajectory of progress of the University of Ibadan dipped significantly. I will not mention the names and the eras of those vice chancellors, but what happened was that politics became the purpose. There was a subversion of hierarchy in terms of appointments. Cleavages dominated the institution. And then, of course, there was a fluidity of power was exchanged or was replaced by the oligarchy of power, where certain interests took over the administration of the university. Rather than what you expect, the contestation for ideas was replaced by groupthink. Long-term planning was replaced by short-term thinking. And then what you have is that people were allocated position, balancing of power, balancing of appointment, you know, and which is what is dominating today. So you appoint people to position not necessarily on the basis of their competence, but simply because you wanted to satisfy interests. So you now identify on campus there are interests like Christians, non-Christians, or Christians and Muslims are in a group, and they have also, but you'll find that even among students. You will have strong ASU members, not so strong ASU members. You will have those who are standing under the umbrella, those who are holding the broom, you know, and then those who are holding the broom standing under the umbrella. You will have UI graduates, non-UI graduates. You have all kinds of sub-ethnic interests. All of these things are now, you know what it leads to in administration? It's called sub-optimization. There is no collective consensus. There is no focus. And when this happens, basically, it is impossible for a university or any organization to work effectively and efficiently. There are defined indicators of growth in any organization. And when you have sub-optimization, you have these kind of cleavages, it is impossible for any organization to grow. So basically, what I want to try to do, and why I have shown interest, I was in this process 5 years ago, and I'm showing interest again, I'm saying we can do things differently. And we are going to do it differently by looking at ourselves. We need to find out exactly where we are. So we need an institutional self-awareness research about ourselves and what our stakeholders think about us. And then we need to begin to reform our system. We need courage. And then, of course, you know, one of the problems is the problem of leadership. There's what is called the law of exponential decay. And what it happens, basically, if you have an incompetent leader, it does not affect the system incrementally or arithmetically. It affects the system geometrically. But competence at a lower level does not work itself way up the system. So basically what we are seeing today is the normalization of deviance within as an organizational culture within the University of Ibadan. And so no matter how much you put into this system, it is not likely that you are going to get the mileage out of it. And that is what has shown basically in terms of the fact that we have spent so much construction, but we are not building minds of our students. You know, students are going about aimlessly without necessarily any sense of focus, because most of what we do basically are now outside the classroom. We are basically struggling for position. We are looking for how to gain advantage, how to get an official car, so we can, you know, and basically that's what it drives. And you know, no amount of wishful thinking is going to turn a university that operates that way into a world-class institution. And we cannot compete. But we need also to raise funds, because new realities are staring us in the face now. So the new VC of this university cannot just be an administrator waiting to spend money. It cannot be an individual who is tied by conflict of interest, who is looking for a platform to better himself. He must be somebody who is known to be selfless and committed, who has the capacity, for instance, to focus on the common good within in the institution, and then raise funds for this institution to meet its mandate. The realities basically are clear. Dwindling oil revenue, that's one clear thing. The devaluation of the Naira, because we need to source a lot of our equipment from outside the country, which is going to affect us negatively. We're looking at the possibility of industrial instability within it, because the unions, for instance, are waiting to renegotiate their agreements. So what I'm saying basically is that the new vice chancellor must be aware of these realities and must take necessary steps. Part of the problem of instability is issue of funding, actually, in the sense that if a university like the University of Ibadan can raise its own money and decide to enter into contract with its own staff at every point in time to be able to pay them, and when the government is able to sort out itself with the generality, he can get his own reimbursement, he will discover that there will be stability here. So we need to be able to generate the equivalent of what we get from government every year, which is about $13 billion, which is just $64 million, which is not a lot of money. If you look at it, $13 billion for 5,200 staff is just about $64 million that we spend. The University of Hong Kong alone spends about $102 million on its library. And these are the institutions we are competing with. So my agenda basically is that we now come and sit down and focus on ourselves and settle down as an institution, devoid of ethnic sentiments, devoid of all these prebendal sentiments. We work together, look at the institution, have an institutional growth mindset, and then we will be able to change our destiny and then surpass what those who founded this university achieved in the 60s and 70s.
Yeah, thank you, sir. During the last discussion segment for the Vice Chancellor of Aspirant, what actually came to fore was the issue of a student relationship. Looking at the aspirant, do they really have a good relationship with the student? Though there are fillers that you might have been relating well with the student. But do you actually see yourself as student-friendly fellow?
Well, you know, we are here because of our students. Basically, one of the things that makes me very happy often is when I interact with my students. Because, you know, the truth basically is that without a student body, without a vibrant student body, especially in terms of having a student voice, in terms of their unionism, which is actually a platform for leadership development, it's not possible for us to have a complete system. You see, that's why, first of all, the leader must have some level of philosophical clarity about the purpose of education. Human beings are not resources like land and capital. I'm bringing in the concept of humanistic management, where human beings are assets. There are things human beings can do that you can't do with your computers. The point basically is that we must create total students. You know, in terms of our vision statements, in terms of the university mission, one of the things that we say we are going to do is to try as much as possible to produce students who are worthy in character and learning. And in fact, the character is even foregrounded over and above the issue of learning. We need to be able to operationalize all this in terms of our behavior. Our students must be exposed to every other critical intelligence skills that they will need to be able to function effectively in society. Not just to be cerebral individuals, people who have book knowledge, but also people who are responsible, who have integrity, who are able to bring society to the point where society wants to be. So we are not there at this point in time. So one of the things I would like to do, and which I have done over the years, because I'm patron to a number of students' organizations, UCJ is one of them. You know, there are the entrepreneurial groups that I'm a patron to. There are quite a number of them. At the beginning of every year, I interact with them a lot, and then we come and we hold discussions and so on. So I've been involved with students a lot. Now, but we need to go beyond that. We need to operationalize community service, for instance, for our students. We need to institute opportunities for students to exhibit their talents by creating research and development clusters. We need to create a business clusters for entrepreneurs on campus for them to be able to exercise some of their skills and abilities. When we do that, and then we establish integrity footprint on campus, it promotes student representation. There is nothing stopping students, for example, being represented in faculty boards. They may not be represented at the same level, but they must, leadership by observing, leadership is, you develop more that responsible leadership capacity in them by allowing them to be represented and then to take decisions at critical areas involve them. So representation is one of the things that I would take care of. And then of course, like I said, community service will be, because those are some of the skills. We want students who are responsible, who have some empathy for society. We are not going to be, you see, this idea of fencing up of our students and creating elites who have no attachment with society at all, who have no sense of giving back to the society, it does not end up producing the kind of leaders that we want for the society. That's why today, when we are complaining that the National Assembly they are taking so much for salaries. It's also a failure of the university system. Because the university system have trained these individuals very well for them to recognize that they owe something back to society, then, of course, you wouldn't have to preach so much about this to them at the level where they are in leadership position. Then the other thing I see that is so developing is that you find a lot of our students are so much involved in when they have their student week, they are more interested in organizing parties. They bring in people, for instance, to give lectures and then collect money from them. You don't see them involved in community initiatives. You don't see them involved in social activism. All is about eating as soon. And that, you know, it doesn't really show that we're impacting these students at all. So we are going to discuss with the students and ensure that the Student Union Week is a major event on campus for social activism, for community development, with the full support of the institution. And so that by the time a student passes through this institution, whether he or she likes it, there will be something in him or her that makes it impossible for him to be aloof, to be a bystander, and not to be involved in society. And my ambition is that anywhere the students are being celebrated, young people are celebrated, anywhere in the world, I want to be able to predict that it's an Ibadan student. Anywhere you hear that somebody is excelling, you hear a story of integrity, you hear a story of a superlative performance, without mentioning the name, I want to be able to boast that it's an Ibadan, a University of Ibadan student. That, in fact, will give me the greatest satisfaction in life.
Thank you very much.
Yeah.
As regards the university system, we do understand that it goes beyond the academic staff.
Yes.
We have the non-academic staff.
Yes.
The academic technologies.
Yes.
We have students also on campus.
Yes.
And with the power currently operating in the university,
yes,
we found out that there are much participation of academic staff in administration.
Yes.
Which leads to marginalization of administrative staff. What do you think we can do to curb this menace and also restrain the effects this has had on the university negatively?
Yes, you know, this is a historical problem. It started, in fact, the disdain for administrative staff is historical. It's also historical from the fact that you have a colonial caste system. You remember the whole concept of the boy's quota, comes from the fact that under the colonial system, everybody was a boy, every black man was a boy. If you look at the design of the UI environment, there is a segregation of facilities. You will have, for instance, the junior staff quarters. That's colonialism, colonial caste system. For you have your junior staff quarters, you have your senior staff quarters, you have your professorial quarters, you have the none of that, you have common room for senior staff, there's nothing for junior staff. You have a refreshment areas for a staff club for senior staff, for students. And so there is no converging point, even by staff, for staff and students with the academic staff. So this is one of the things that it is in fact so disturbing that so many years after independence that we can sustain, continue to sustain and justify this. And this is where, for instance, the non-academic staff were so marginalized and they became so discouraged that you will not believe that we have so many of them, but training for non-academic staff has, in the last time, in the last 20 or so years, has been so minimal. So basically what we need to do is to redress that. There's too much encroachment of academic staff now into administrative functions. For instance, you know, wardens of halls. You know, there's adhocization of positions. And what has that done? At least a third of the teaching time hour that we should spend in the classroom, we are now spending more in administration. And what is this administration about? You're looking at people who are selling beef, professors who are selling beef, alakpata. You have professors who are hawking dried fish. You have professors who are pure water. So we have professors who are involved in traffic control on campus. And so what basically happens is that we move people from the... And because there is no research grants, we don't have research grants to occupy people, and the inspiration to teach is so low, we end up with professors now devoting their time to non-teaching and non-research core services. And so more and more we are encroaching into the areas where administrative staff can actually perform. So we also need to correct the issue of representation. Now there's so much politics on campus that people are recruited to Senate. You know, because people want to control the politics of campus. So we have lost a sense of what we, our mission, our primary mission and vision is. So if we assess ourselves on the basis of all parameters, in terms of the university vision, in terms of the whole idea of being a world-class institution, of meeting societal needs, I think there is no return on investment for the Nigerian people. It is not enough for us to say that we are producing X number of graduates. The question which you ask yourself, what are the quality of these graduates we are producing? So, and we have already told that a lot of the people we are producing are not employable. So basically, on all parameters, for a government that wants return on its investment, the people that are demanding, for instance, a return on investment from the institution, I think basically we need to go and sit down and ask ourselves a very fundamental question. Have a soul-searching, create society opportunities for ourselves and tell ourselves that Nigerian people deserve more from our institutions. And now, what I'm saying basically is not something that is peculiar to the University of Ibadan alone, but I'm saying that the University of Ibadan is particularly well positioned as a leader in this country to be able to catalyze the transformation that we're expecting in this nation through its educational institutions. And basically, that's what drives my passion, and that is why I'm interested in coming out again the second time. The first time I was third on the list, now I'm coming out again to say, look, things can work differently. We can have a better use for our money. We can have a different business model in terms of how we go about the business of higher education in this country. And then, of course, we can produce students who are better able to compete globally, and then, of course, meet the demands of our own local environments. In fact, one of the things that you can look at is the human development indices in Nigeria, which are so green. It's an evidence of leadership failure. And the leadership failure is not just only external to the external society. Also, you see evidence of leadership failure. Because if you look at any organization that is performing well, it is because they have been able to bring together the best minds and the best individuals to be able to solve the problems of the organization. But what do we have? Basically now is that it's the creation of incompetent leadership. In fact, there's subversion of hierarchy. You know, you have the problem of balancing of appointments. You know, you give people positions not necessarily because they have the wherewithal, but because they belong to a particular camp. Then you of course have this whole tendency of decapitating competent leadership in order for you to be able to create positions. You are creating positions just to be able to satisfy people's needs, you know, so you are creating offices and so on and so forth. These are things that should not happen in institutions. Institutions basically, universities basically should model societies that work. When people have a problem outside, they should come to the university system. Now, for the university now to be replicating the dysfunctions of the larger society itself is a tragedy indeed.
Thank you, sir. Right now, there is no power in electricity. And it seems that the university keeps spending on generators, as you have rightly said. The part of your action plan, if you become the vice chancellor, is to source for alternative or renewable sources of energy. How do you intend doing this? Looking at the fact that, for instance, solar energy is relatively expensive.
You know, the truth basically is that 5 years ago, I would have been giving you a different strategy. I would have gone for an independent power system for the University of Ibadan. And in fact, the business model then was that both the residents on campus, the unions, the university, we will all collaborate with the permission of the federal government and have an independent power plant here that will generate power 24/7. And then we work out a business model that will give them return on their own investment. You know, I mean, those who are residents of campus and so on and so forth. And then we sell power to ITA, sell power to institutions around and our environment. That was 5 years ago. We were ready to do that. Now, we are in a situation of flux now. You will not want to make a big investment now on power supply and only to find out, for instance, that the government has sorted out the issue of power, because the cheapest source of power still remains the power holding company and all their subsidiary IBEDC, Electricity Development Company, can still supply power to us much cheaper than we can generate for ourselves, because there are other issues in terms of infrastructure, maintenance of infrastructure, in terms of the staff and labor and issues that you have to contend with. So, in other words, what we can do basically now is that we have to wait a while. Now, my focus now is on predictability of power, availability of power, and then of course efficiency. And that does not cost much to do. It doesn't cost much money to do. Now, 20 years ago, we already knew we had problems with power supply to our laboratories and to our institutions generally. But rather than changing the design of our buildings in order to reflect this reality, we still went ahead and started still build buildings in the same power inefficient ways. We did not adjust designs to incorporate alternative power system. For instance, there's nothing stopping us from powering our classroom with solar power during the day and having backup systems for our laboratories to ensure that they have. There's nothing really stopping us from doing that. So we have no excuse not to have power supply in our classrooms. We have no excuse not to have power supply regularly in our laboratories. The other kind of system that we can then manage and redistribute in such a way that academic areas are given priority. So in other words, we should still be able to manage the problem where we have. And then, okay, what other thing? In terms of expansion and development of the institution, we also did not take into consideration the fact that we will now need to invest in power infrastructure. And so we still started spreading out and throwing buildings all over the place without looking at the fact that we need to pipe power to them and that we do not have what it takes. We don't have enough supply. We need about 5 megawatts. We get just about one, and so on and so forth. And these are some of the issues. That's why I'm saying the problem of this university is not a problem of funds or so on. It's a problem of planning and execution. It's a problem of strategic thinking. And this is, we put this basically at the question of leadership. So basically, that's really the approach to the issue of power supply. You know, now let's take the issue of ICT. Now, we went into ICT as if we were just distributing gadgets. Now, there was no policy. There was no technology acceptance model. There was no, standardization. Everybody was just doing what he liked. And at the end of the day, after spending almost ₦1 billion, we started digging up cables all over the place again. And for some of these cables, we don't even know where they are. There was no business architecture, no strategy for deployment, no process re-engineering. And so we spent a lot of money also trying to computerize bursary. Over the last 10, 15 years, we have not been able to computerize because we are not approaching these issues from an intelligent perspective. So we are not running an institution that intelligently. And that's basically our fundamental problem. When we come down to the brass tacks of running this institution with an intelligent framework, you will see that there will be unexpected transformation, and that is why leadership is very important, because everything ends up with leadership. If you have the right kind of leadership with integrity, because everything rises also and falls with integrity. The best brain without integrity is actually very dangerous to any society.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Currently, Nigeria is experiencing wind of change, and for the change we truly desire for, I felt it should start in an university environment.
Sure, certainly.
We talked about the non-research course service being engaged by the academic staff.
Yeah.
The recent development shows that research in the university died at infant stage. And what do you have to say about this? The quality and implementation of research currently on board, how will university work in executing that in the nearest future, and the panacea to ensuring that research conducted in University of Ibadan, being a national treasure, does not die at infant stage. Thank you very much.
I think it will actually be a disservice to hardworking colleagues who are doing very good research not to acknowledge the fact that there are very highly competent researchers on this campus, highly competent researchers. And that there are people, in fact, who are very competent and astute even in management and administration. What has happened basically is that they have been beheaded. The management system has beheaded this group of people who are competent. Basically, the first approach to research is, first of all, restoring the confidence of people in the system. The second thing is that for a period of 7 years or more, you discover that we have spent perhaps the university has committed about 100 million of its own resources. or a little bit over for research, but we have spent close to 800 million on cars. When you add the cost of insurance, the cost of fuel and so on and so forth, you can imagine the priorities. Now, the research approach has to be such that there is funding. You know, we have a university mission research. Good enough, they've created the university has created the research foundation. We also have a research management office. I think the whole idea is to strengthen these outfits within the institution. Then focus on researches that we will align with our university mission, which is actually impacting on society. Basically, you know, we want to bring about societal changes. We want to bring about transformation. So we must create a research cluster that integrates the Center for Entrepreneurship so that we can now translate the products of this research into incubators, where we can work with, for instance, Bank of Industry, for instance, and so on and so forth, with the Center for Entrepreneurship, and over a period of time, we incubate an idea, a business idea, we incubate a business, and so on and so forth. So we must be able to now bridge the gap and help, because there are a lot of patentable products that are ready for implementation. But the Nigerian society is not the kind of, invention-friendly environment. But we now have to find a way of working with the private sector in order for us to be able to bring some of these ideas into fruition. And I think basically, if we do that, you will see that a lot of the problem that we have in people's focus will shift back again from politics to research laboratories, from seeking for positions to the classroom. And I think that's one of the things we need to do also, I think, is that we need to be able to operationalize community service, in other words, in the promotion criteria. Just as we also integrate it with student academic evaluation, we should also integrate it in terms of the promotion criteria, as well as teaching. Teaching must be used to evaluate people also in terms of their promotion. That is the only way you can get people, rather than just talking about research. Sometimes some of the research actually are just literature review. We need to be able to get something back to the students by ensuring that good teachers are rewarded. And when good teachers are rewarded, there is a more effective learning environment that is created by that. So some of those issues of research, one of the things we need to do is to look for an approach to sustainable funding of research. We can't always be blowing hot and cold. Today we have money, we share it, which is the approach we've been facing. If there's no money, then everybody goes to look. We need to be able to set aside on every periodic basis a certain amount for sustainable funding of research, for sustainable funding of laboratories. We must not behave like the prodigal son. Everything we earn is what we spend. We must set aside a percentage, and I think council can give leadership in this to ensure that whatever UI makes from its IGR, a certain amount is set aside every year to ensure that over a period of 10 years and so on. We can't solve the problem of UI by terminating progress and change at the end of the tenure of one vice chancellor. We must have a sustainability plan where we have a concerted period of over 15 years. And in 15 years, we tell ourselves that this university will be wind of government funds, will be wind of the problems of the Nigerian society. In 2014 alone, University of Harvard exceeded its investment plans by 80 points, even in spite of the economic crisis in the U.S., because they have the intellect and so as an intellectual institution, we should be able to outperform the best banks in terms of our investment. So these are some of the things I think we can do. The details are contained in my vision document, and some of them I will not be able to say now because you observe that I'm still going to sit before an interview panel. But I think I feel that it's important for us to talk to students as well. I if we are here because of the students, and you come to me to say that I should address you and on behalf of the student body, and then I say I don't have the time for one reason, I don't think that's right for me. And that's why I feel that it's important for me to share some of our ideas with you as far as some of these issues are concerned.
All right, sir. Thank you. Pause. All right, sir. You've actually spoken about most of the issues that you would have loved to have as contained in your mission statement, your action plan. One thing that the student would love to know is about computerization of registration, that they can be in a particular place and also, I mean, conclude their registration exercise, then their result as well, how often or how they can really get the result on time without any hazard.
Well, those are the things that I believe that are more or less like routines now. Even private universities in Nigeria have achieved that. But you know, the point basically is that the platform, internet platform, the local area network is, we don't have a local area network here. The other thing basically is that it's so difficult to access the UI website from outside sometimes. You know, it's a fit, and all of this have to do with our original initial approach to this business. Now what is happening now basically is a conscious attempt is being made now to rectify some of the problems. But of course, you know, when you have a bad foundation from the beginning, it's difficult to rectify it, except you want to dismantle everything. For instance, registration should be, students should be able to register for their courses during the holidays. But if results are not ready, then that becomes a problem. Or if the platform is not accessible, it becomes a problem. Now, what it also means is that each of these students should also have his own, a password, an access code. But of course, you see, in the last 2 years, you'll see that there have been a little bit of improvement on that. We cannot replicate. Part of the problem is that we are replicating the same processes on the internet. You see, there must be a process re-engineering. You cannot take the inefficiencies of the system, the paper system, again, you translate it completely into the technology system. So that in itself, you don't do it that way. So we have not really sorted out some of those issues. And then we don't even have the records. You have to have complete documentation already of the information, the historical information, in order for you to be able to integrate with the information, current information. So that if a student failed some courses 3 or 4 years ago, the system should be able to flag the registration. And so that, you know, the bridging and the managing of the process itself is, and the human factor as well, that even the individuals who are involved, the lecturers themselves, we all also have to buy in and be part of this transformation. But of course, more than that, again, is the power problem. So we have to solve each and every one of these problems, the fundamental, the root problems, and in order for us to be able to address some of the issues that have arisen. But one of the things I would try to do, and which I believe is very doable, is to bring in a system that will make it possible for students to have easy access to the local area network.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Questions are in twofold. When you talk about the award of projects by the university management, and there are several cases of projects being compromised, the standard of project being compromised due to the issue of we want 25% of the projects to be into my personal accounts amidst others. These are news in the university. And how do you ensure that there will be probity to ensure that we mitigate against corruption? That is the first question. And the second question is, there are reports, because we are now on social media, there are reports from agri students who inbox us personally that during your administration as the director of distance learning, that there was an introduction of the pre-degree program, which was later scrapped, whereby students have been admitted, they've already paid. What do you have to say about that? And lastly, the issue of pushing paper. There are a lot of time in which the university student login bureau will complain about, we are ready to start this project, but you have to push paper for about a month, 2 months, 3 months, which at the end of the day lead to student protesting before the paper is finally signed. Thank you very much.
Well, you know, the issue of demand for kickback and so on in contrast, that's a very weighty issue. The truth basically I must tell you is that I have no information. Whatever it is that has happened in terms of on campus or are still matters for speculation. If people have information, probably it's better for them to put information forward. But I can tell you that the best way to avoid such compromises where they do exist is to ensure that you have an open and transparent administration, that you put in accountability measures in place. If you have open biddings, for instance, where people understand and members of the public can contribute, whether you are bidding, they can scrutinize the bid online, over a period of time, waiting time, where people can make their contributions and so on and so forth. Once there is openness, once there is personal integrity by the leadership, I think such issues will not come up at all. So it's important for us to have openness, to be transparent in terms of financial transactions. And then, of course, the university accounts, the university should follow a budget, do a budget, and then, of course, also publish its accounts and let people have access to the accounts. So we must implement the Freedom of Information bill. We must implement it here on campus. Without being compelled to do so, we should allow people have access to the accounts, to bursary information. The bursary runs like a shrine, and this is part of the reasons why there are speculations sometimes. And that's why sometimes people raise issues of corruption and so on. The question of the pre-degree program, there's no one person who can introduce anything in UI. It started from the Faculty of Science. It's not even pre-degree. It was a program that was meant to bridge the gap in achievement between science, for science courses. So it was called, it arose from years of problems that scientists were having with individuals entering into the faculties of science, to the faculties, science-based faculties. They would discover that people were having problems with mathematics and with critical thinking and so on and so forth. And distance learning was now supposed to create a bridge link program, a program that was meant to prepare students to come in as students into the Faculty of Science. It was not for all courses. It was basically to handle science-based courses. And then, of course, you know that in vet medicine in Agri, also there was a problem of low subscription. And it was felt that if the university was able to develop a program like that, where there is an intensive one-year preparation for students, a percentage of such students can be given an opportunity based on their performance to enter into, compete with other students to become students of UI. And that was what we did. I just happened to be the individual who spearheaded it because I was director of the Distance Learning Center. Now, politics came in. At some point, it was a problem of politics where some individuals, powerful individuals within the system, basically subverted it. But the university still ensured that those who were qualified and fit to be admitted that year were given opportunities. But the good story about it was that over a substantial population of those students, on their own merits, gained admission into the institution. And that was, in fact, for what gave me satisfaction. Even without any help and so on within the system, a substantial percentage of students were admitted into UI, and on their own merits, while the others who met a particular threshold of performance were admitted. And then the program was scrapped. That was basically what happened with that program. I just happened to have been the director of the Distance Learning Center. It is not true that people paid fees and were not admitted. That's not true. They paid fees to be part of the program, and they cannot complain, for instance, that they were not well taught, because it was a very effective program. They were taught by the staff of UI. And we were also very careful also not to make any promise to students to say, look, because I think what some of them were looking for at that point in time was to say, okay, I pay, I come in, the Nigerian thing, and then I must be admitted. There was no way UI would be involved in that kind of thing. I think you asked a third one about the lodgings issue. The truth basically sometimes is that, and I think we need to say that, so what the university has said basically is that the university is subsidizing students' accommodation. And I don't think it is right for a university to subsidize consumption of energy and accommodation of students. If you look at the accounts that is published, you will observe that there is a gap, there is a deficit. And from time to time, the Vice Chancellor publishes this information, and nobody has risen up to say, for instance, that information that was published is wrong in terms of how the funds are spent, because the funds are spent from the halls. So my belief is that sometimes the delay is caused by the fact that university have to look for money from elsewhere in order to make up for the gap. And if that happens, I think the rational thing to do, basically in this, is that if you are consuming power, since you are not paying tuition, it is just only fair that those who are using the utilities and consuming power should be able to meet at least minimally the cost of accommodation, the cost of power consumption, and so that you can live a decent life. That's the way I see that such matters should be, rather than subsidies, university providing subsidies in those areas. I think we are compromising even the ability of the university to give you students a quality service by allowing university to take what should be spent in the academic areas now to begin to give you power, to subsidize your accommodation, when you know exactly how much you pay outside the campus. So I think the Vice Chancellor has worked very well in terms of handling accommodation. You know, some of the problems also in processing by the Lodgings Bureau, I think I have explained, can also be as a result of the fact that people are not following financial processes well. I have experienced that a lot of people are financial illiterates. So that by the time he gets to the VC and he returns it, but the stories that students will hear will be that the VC has refused to sign. But there are procedures, and I think more training of those who manage us will reduce this time lag between approval and implementation. I think that's one area, for instance, that one can say that there has been some level of progress and stability. And the other area has to do with the issue of the quality assurance is now being built up. There is also the Center for Teaching and Learning that's also trying to address some of the issues of a deficit in teaching quality. I think basically we need to strengthen those units and to ensure that at the end of the day, within the next 10 years, I'm not looking at 5 years for the University of Ibadan to become a world-class. It may take up to about a world-class university. We need 10, 15 years of concerted, sustainable effort for us to be able to attain where we were in 1973, among the best 20 in the world.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much.
On a rather final note, students most times they dread the student disciplinary committee. Do you think the SDC had lived up to its expectation, or there is need for reform?
I think there should be reform. Sometimes also is that the fact that some of the reasons why we take students to the SDC sometimes is not. This is a personal opinion. They are not the best reasons. Somebody is rude to a lecturer, then you. You expel the students. I think there are very ridiculous reasons. Sometimes it borders on ego of certain individuals who feel they are so powerful in the system. We must know that SDC should be an opportunity for reform. We shouldn't just foreclose students' life. Their own ambition, just on very flimsy reasons. But there are very serious criminal, in fact, things, crimes that are committed sometimes that border on criminality. I would not suggest that we mitigate such, but there are others where we can reform the system in such a way that students can, some can pay fines, they can go on community service within the institution or outside. And then, of course, give them a proper period of reform. We can't just ask people to go rusticated for one or two sessions without necessarily being interested in whether the person actually has learned a lesson. So it's important for us to go back and look at what we are doing. Because we are talking about reforming the legal system outside. We should give leadership from here. And I think that basically that's what I think, whether for students or whether for staff, we need to be able to show that we are thinking people. And that's where I stand.
Thank you so much, sir. On a final note, if you don't become the vice chancellor of this university, will you still give your support to the incoming administration?
Yes, I have always supported the university in every sense. This is where my life is. I have been here for 30 years. The university gave me my first job when it was difficult to get a job elsewhere. So the truth basically is that I will be lying to say that anybody who becomes VC I'll be able to work with everybody. But there are very competent individuals who are in the race with whom I can actually work, whether or not I'm VC. But there are also, you must know also that there are personality issues sometimes also involved with the problem of leadership, and that it's not just everybody you can work with. But when it comes to the university, I will always place the University of Ibadan first above personal ambition, personal sentiments. I will do my job very well. I'll work with my students, and then, of course, ensure that everywhere I find myself, that I carry the university's banner the truth basically is that there's no university in Nigeria like the University of Ibadan. And that is why people stay here. That's why they don't go anywhere. So, and that is why some of us are interested in keeping the traditions of this place so that we don't allow it to go the way of so many other institutions. This university is an asset to this nation. And I think basically it is our duty as individuals to ensure that the country gets the best out of this place. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. It has been wonderful speaking with you.
Thank you very much. All right.